two people to do a dozen sandwiches, one dessert, 1 gallon of tea, and it would be great if two people can help set up and serve. So if you're interested in helping out there, please let them know. And there will be some light refreshments and food in the back after church if you'd like to stay and fellowship. When clouds threaten, look for signs of light and life. A rainbow, a bird, a gentle rain, the waters of baptism. These gifts of love bring hope and wash us clean. Trust your promise and love. Amen.
Amen.
Hymn number, did I hear 374? 374. Shown us. In trust and gratitude, we pray. Amen. Amen. Please pass the peace of Christ with your neighbor.
Jane, I owe you a hug. Good to see you.
You're still growing, aren't you?
I was
up. That's really cool.
Thank you. Good to hear your voice, man.
Thanks, man.
You're still growing. Around the tree.
Yeah, doesn't he seem
calm? Hey.
Yeah. I hope so. Yep.
Hey, Jeremy.
It's all right.
You can never go. All of my
hugs. Oh, no. I'm mad.
Oh, that's so good.
Thank you.
many joys this morning?
Thank you, Lord. The music has been beautiful. My words have gotten a lot better.
All right.
Better every day.
Are you behaving?
No.
That's funny. No, we're glad you're here. And we did just hear a joy, Jane, for sure.
I was just going to say we're glad Kent was here.
I'm glad all of you are here. I mean,
we just don't really see you very often.
Y'all need to stop. What about concerns today?
You need to remember Kathy. She has surgery tomorrow. Our good friend Tom Mitchell has surgery on Tuesday.
Okay.
And Brother Bob.
Okay.
Gene McConnell.
Gene McConnell.
Kathy and Bruce.
Kathy and Bruce.
The situation in our country, in our world.
Yeah, a lot of stuff going on in a lot of places for sure. All right, if you all would, let's all bow our heads in prayer, please. Gracious God, we love you today. We're so thankful. Thankful for who you are and all that you do. God, for loving us. Loving us even when we were unlovable. We might even add still unlovable. But you still show us your grace. You still show us mercy. And we come into your presence this day with joy and gladness in our hearts. And yet, there's so much going on in all of our lives that we don't understand. We might even question things in our world. But we still got to trust you today, God. Just be with us. Continue to walk beside us and continue to mold us and shape us today into your people. God, just help us to be your church. Help us to continue to love you and to love others. And for those names that have been mentioned here, spoken and unspoken, we pray, God, for a special touch. Be it their families, their caretakers, for all that's involved. Just be very close to them. Again, Lord, just allow your Holy Spirit to move here among us this day. For we ask it in the name of Jesus, and amen.
Amen.
Our scripture this morning is from Leviticus chapter 11. Leviticus chapter 11. I'm just going to read you a couple of verses. Verses 44 and 45. Let me share this with you. Said an old man walks into town square with a big sign around his neck that reads, "Wisdom for a nickel." A skeptical passerby tosses a nickel into the old man's hat and says, "Okay, wise guy, what's your message?" The old man looks up, grinning ear to ear, and says, "Never spend a nickel on something you can get for free." But in Leviticus chapter 11, verses 44 and 45, we hear these words. "For I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourselves, therefore, and be holy, for I am holy. You shall not defile yourself with any swarming thing that crawls on the ground. For I am the Lord who brought you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. You shall, therefore, be holy, for I am holy." This is the word of God today for the people of God.
Thank you, God.
Amen.
Amen.
Who wants to give us a recap of the last 3 or 4 weeks' sermons? You got out of this last week, Steve, because you weren't here the week before, but you were here last week and you're back today. And I told you I'd get you.
When you got me.
We've been thinking a lot about calling, and it simply goes back to, and I've been thinking a lot about it, you know, the fields are ripe for harvest. They were ripe in Jesus' day, they're still just as ripe today, which tells me and reminds me that there are many people out there today ready to receive this message. But our trouble is not outside the walls of the church. Our trouble is within the walls of the church. Because it would seem that we don't have enough laborers who are willing to go. So that's us. But we discover, even through Moses, and Moses' calling, you recall that he was out in the wilderness and he sees this bush that is on fire but yet is not consumed, and yet he steps aside to see what might be happening. Well, number one, he is on holy ground, and then secondly, God's calling him. Calling him to lead a people that I don't know if they really wanted led or not, to be honest. Some days they were obedient, other days they weren't, and the ups and the downs, and eventually we get to the point last week that God tells even Moses, well, go on, take you and the people, go up to the land of milk and honey, but guess what? I'm not going with you. But Moses appeals to God. And Moses' appeal is simply this, that God, isn't it your presence? Isn't it your presence that goes with us, that makes us distinct, makes us different from all the other folks? It's your presence that goes with us. So we can translate all that into our calling and who God's called us to be, and we can complain just like Moses did, but still that does not get us out of our calling. And we can also understand today that it's God's presence that goes with us, wherever that might be. But still, we read even here today in Leviticus, and you're going to continue to read this, that God said that I need you to be holy, for I am holy. Both verses today, you're going to read it in chapter 19 and verse 2, chapter 20, verses 7 and 26, in chapter 21 and verse 8. Well, chances are, when things are repeated that often, it's probably important, right? But what does it mean to be holy? If I were just simply to say to you today, be holy, that would be the sermon, and y'all would rejoice. But the sermon today is simply, be holy, because God's holy. Amen. And send you out. What would you leave here with? Because how do you define holy? What is your definition? What does holy God mean? Are we saying today that God's holy, that he's perfect, he has all these attributes and this, that, and other, and God wants us to live like him? Well, how long would that last? How long would you be holy? Matter of fact, how many of you have been holy this week? Are any of you being holy? Or is this your holy day? So you came to church today. This is your holy. We're just going to be holy today. Y'all are cracking me up. I would imagine there was a time in my life when this was my holy day. I was just coming to church one day. I was going to be holy. Then I was going to let her rip during the week. Okay? But to be holy. How do I define that? Because how we define that will mean whether we live up to it or not. Because if we define holy today as being, well, God wants me to be perfect this week. God wants me to do the right thing all the time. To make the right decisions. To say the right things. Do the right things. All this is about being holy. Well, I'm going to leave here today. I'm going to go home this afternoon. Something's going to frustrate me, and there goes the holiness. And then here I am scrambling, trying to get back on track. So is that what God's saying? Because if I define it in that manner, I'm almost saying to myself that God's asking me to do something that God already knows that I can't. It's not possible. So why is he asking me to be holy when I can't be holy? Which means we probably should take a closer look at the word holy, right? So how do we define, or how does Scripture define, or more than that, how does Hebrew define the word holy? David, you want me to call you up this morning and you do the definition?
No, sir, I think you do a good job.
Oh, you'll suck up now. But if we look at that word in the Hebrew, and there again, I never claim, half the time I can't even pronounce English. Okay, so if I do not pronounce the Hebrew correct, you understand. But it looks like to me it's pronounced Kadosh. And this tells you where my mind goes when I think of things like this, because I kept thinking about, I've heard that word before. And then I got to thinking about Kung Fu Panda. Y'all watch that movie? Part 4 is getting ready to come out. We're home. Okay. But I got to thinking about this word, Kadosh, and I remembered in the Kung Fu movies that there was one, remember when he could destroy the enemy with just saying the one word? Kadosh. It's Kadosh, isn't it? Skidoosh. There's my Kung Fu people.
Landon can probably tell you more. But...
Oh, don't put it on Landon, okay? If we're going to own this, we're going to own it, okay? If we can't wait till number 4 goes out, we're going to own it. But it was Skadoosh. But that's how my mind works. And we may get back to Skadoosh later. But Kadosh. And Kadosh in Scripture means to be set apart for a specific purpose. I might be able to live up to that, right? Set apart for a specific purpose. So then that got me to thinking, how many things around our house, or how many things in your life might you call holy? Anything around your house? Any thoughts? Is this holy? Holy? Yes, no. Is this set apart for a specific purpose? Yeah. How many of y'all, how many families here, all of you use the same toothbrush? Y'all don't love each other very well, do you? You and Coach don't use the same toothbrush?
No.
She said, heavens. No. Okay. Specific purpose. Specific task. Wilmer, you can't answer, and I figure Keith can't answer. Anybody know what this is? Shh. You farm, you can't answer.
He didn't say it loud enough.
You do have to push it right here. neat little gadget. Tells me if an outlet's working, light bulb, plug in. Specific purpose, specific task. And like I say, we could go on and on this morning. I never know. What's this?
Oh, I've got those.
Why you got them?
See where I'm going.
But still, a specific thing and a specific task. Really can't use it. You might try to use it as a hammer, but how long would this work as a hammer? Not long. So if we think about this word holy, and think about it in a way that God has chosen you and me. Specific purpose, specific task. How does that change the way that we live our lives? Doesn't it change everything? Because how many of you can leave here today, if we're at the end of the sermon right now, how many of you could leave here today just simply knowing that you had a specific purpose and a specific task as you walked out those doors? How many of you can live up to that? If you all, if you can't live up to that, we just as well go home now. But I can live up to that. Can you not? Just leaving here today knowing that I have a specific purpose and a specific task, that God has set me apart for that. I can live up to that. But you see, if I leave here today thinking that Mike has to be perfect, that I always have to say and do the right thing, I failed before I even get out of this building. And that's why God's saying to the people, said, I need you to be holy. I'm holy. Because God is God. There's no other God. I don't care what the world tells you, there's only one God. And that's what he was trying to get through to Israel, saying, hey, there's only one God. Follow me, you be my people, I'll be your God, and let's roll. And I believe God simply says the same thing to you and I today. You know, allow God to be God and do your specific tasks, be set apart, and do what God's called you to do. Because we make up the body of Christ today. And I'm reminded, let me go here real quick. In 1 Corinthians, I believe it's 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Hear these words, starting at verse 12. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jew or Greek, slave or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. And you can continue reading that later, but you have a unique purpose. In being set apart by God, you have a unique purpose today to share this gospel. And most of you this morning would like me to stand up here and tell you your unique purpose, right? Wouldn't that be nice, Pastor, just tell you, this is your unique purpose, go do it. Well, guess what? I'm not telling you. Even if I know, I'm not telling you. Because you see, as I walked along the building this morning, as you all were singing the doxology, I knew that there was one distinct person here today with a distinct purpose. I knew Kent was here. I could hear his voice. I can recognize his voice. And whether Kent wants to hear this today or not, I don't know, but you got a gift. You might have got it from Mom. I doubt that you got it from Dad. We won't have that discussion this morning. Of course, Jake's yet to come up and sing, so we can't prove it. And if he'd like to come and prove us wrong this morning, and the better I get to know you all, I can recognize some of your gifts and some of your talents. But there again, each one of you today have unique gifts, unique talents, and you've been set apart today to use it for God. We have to ask, are we being holy, right? Are we being holy? Are we using today the gifts that God has given us? Because, you know, there again, if our whole body is the eye, or is an eye, where is our sense? Where is the sense of hearing? Or if our whole body is simply an ear, where is the sense of smell? So we have to function together, and that's why I've always said the reason for the church. All of you are important today. All of you are gathered here today, and even the ones that are not here today, they're just as important, because the ones that are not here today, we're missing part of the body. We can only make up so much. But God wants us to use our gifts. And what I believe today, and this is not scriptural, but I truly believe it with all my heart. I truly believe that God puts people in each of our lives, in all of our lives, in a specific way so that we can share the gospel of Jesus with them. Now, I understand today you can make the argument of God can use anybody and yada, yada, yada. I get it. But I still believe that God puts specific people into our lives to share the gospel. It may be your relationship. It could be somebody you work with, this, that, or another. But it's because of that relationship you have an opportunity to share the gospel. To use your unique gift, your talent, and being set apart by God to share it. And I've seen it. I remember this gentleman, and I may have shared this with you before, but remember this one gentleman that lived in a community, and everybody told me, he said, there's no need to go see him because he's run out. Every pastor that's ever went to see him has been ran off. Well, this is just kind of how I look at it. I thought, well, you just well run me off too. And I thought, well, this is a challenge. I went to visit this older gentleman. But the thing of it is, after we met, we had some common interests. Didn't have to say anything about God. Didn't have to beat him over the head about Jesus. We just shared those common interests. And one of those common interests happened to be cane molasses. Now, how many of you know what I'm even talking about? Any of you ever made cane molasses? A couple of you? How many of you ladies use cane molasses to bake cookies? You're missing it. But making cane molasses is a very, very similar process to maple syrup, but yet different. But because we had that common interest, that allowed us to develop a relationship. And as that relationship developed, it allowed me, through the Holy Spirit, to talk about God, to talk about Jesus. And eventually, this man came to Christ. Now, it had nothing to do with me. I get it. Never does. Never will. But I still believe that God puts people into our lives so that we can be set apart and so that we can use our unique gifts to tell them about Jesus and the love of God. That's why God needs us today to be holy. He's holy. We need to be holy. We need to live in every moment of every second of every day. Now, don't turn this around and say the pastor told you to leave here today and go be perfect. I'm not telling you that. But I am telling you, if you're here today and you're a child of God, you've been set apart. Maybe you're the toothbrush for all we need. Okay? Maybe you need to, and this may be for us, maybe we need to find the electricity, right? You remember some of you, I don't know how Methodist you are, used to be in the United Methodist Church, or somebody stood at the back and they had a long pole. And I forget what the name of that pole was, but if you nodded off, they'd tap you on the head with the pole. Matter of fact, only place I know, the Rehoboth Church in Monroe County, they got the pole in the back. That'd be so much fun. You talk about getting people to pray. That would be my unique gift. That would be my unique gift and talent. Let me wake them up, Lord. I'll get them awake. If I were to play off that idea, I'd have electric in your seats, and I'd have a board up here where I could just touch a button. But if I needed a hallelujah, just push this button. Again, that could be my unique gift and talent. But no, in all seriousness today, be holy. Be holy today because God has called you to be holy. And remember today, it's about being set apart. You're set apart by God today for a specific purpose, for a specific task. And not only that, but go back to last week and remember that God's presence, the reason that you're unique, and the reason that we're special today is simply because God's presence goes with us. Be holy. As Darla comes this morning and brings us a song, what do you have, Darla?
In the
Faith
We Sing, 2152.
2152 in the Faith We Sing. 2152. If you'd like me to pray with you today, I'm more than happy to do so. If you need the church to pray with you, we can. If you need to pray where you're at, take it to God.
Thank you.
Amen. See, I kind of wish that God was more like a Kung Fu Panda. That way I could just do skadoosh, and you all would have to do it. But God gives us a choice, right? Gives us a choice. Join me in our benediction. Go to be signs of hope for all the world to see.
Rainbows in the clouds.
Water in the desert.
Love in a world of hate.
Go to be signs of hope for all the world to know.
Amen.
Amen.